very long time to recover. That's why we used to delay it. But now we are discussing this in these meetings because now we have what we call as endothelial keratoplasty, and we can deliver much better and faster visual outcomes. So that brings us back to this. And we know now that we are living in the era of what we call as component corneal transplant surgery, in which we can replace whatever is diseased and give faster and better results. This is just to give you an idea that how physiological the endothelial keratoplasty has become from up to down. That DMEK, it's become almost physiological way, and that is what we see in our patients also. So this is a patient who underwent a phacoemulsification with IOL and a DMEK surgery, and he recovered full. He was almost 6 parts after a month. So this is, I mean, there's a whole sea change in the way we manage these patients. So coming back to the first clinical situation, I think this case, you can see the edema, it's there, and the patient is also symptomatic. He says that he has hazy vision in the morning. So this is one important point, that a patient will complain of more hazy vision in the morning, and he may also have some symptoms of watering. Then you may suggest that let's do a specular to find out. And as you can see in this case, the left eye is the unaffected better eye, and that doesn't show, that just shows a few spots of otherwise it's fairly normal. The right eye, we couldn't even get a good capture of the endothelium because of the edema. And you cannot go just by the numbers. Sometimes you may just have a printout of the numbers and you may not be seeing the cells on the screen. So it's better not to go by the numbers, because as you can see, it shows as 2400, which is not accurate as it has miscalculated the image. So you should not go by the absolute numbers which come on the specular and then decide to do a procedure. And there is this, the other patient situation too, in which there is no corneal edema. There is, patient has come with slightly hazy vision. So what should we do? Because we do not know whether this vision is hazy because of the cataract or is it because of the cornea. So look at the pachymetry, look at the compactness of the cornea. So that will tell you. So if now the pachymetry is above 580, 600, like in this case, so then we would think of doing a combined procedure to do both phaco and this together. This is the specular of this patient. As you can see, the central specular microscopy, you can see a lot of guttae, although the endothelial cell count is pretty good. And that's what we did. This is the same case, and you can see this is the first post-op day, what it looks like. And I'll just briefly go in and show you what is the procedure like, so that we have a brief idea. It has kind of achieved, a lot of studies have already been done to compare it with endothelial keratoplasty, and it does provide much, much better visual acuity, and other complications are pretty similar. And in fact, it also offers the opportunity for us to have a longer life of the transplant, because a DMEK has shown to have less rejection up till now. It is still not completely proven yet how much less, but it is much less because probably the tissue that you transplant is much less and induces a less risk. So how is it done? I think I'll briefly in 5 minutes I'll just show you a few steps of it. So first you take the donor and remove the Descemet's membrane from the donor. As you can see, we are peeling it off. And once this is peeled off, then nowadays what we do is we mark it. You can mark it with the alphabet which is asymmetrical, like F, so that we know which side is up, which side is down, because it's a very thin membrane, and when you transplant it, it's very easy for it to turn around inside in the eye. And then once you load it, we stain it with trypan blue nicely. And then we have special injectors. There are many injectors available. This is a glass injector. And then you load this, so it becomes like a scroll. The whole membrane is like circular, but it becomes like a scroll, and then you can load it up inside a glass syringe. And once it's loaded, then you go to the patient where you have already removed the bad Descemet's, the pathologic Descemet's of the Fuchs, and then you inject it. So it goes in like a scroll. This is one of the simpler cases in which it unfolded very easily in the right direction. And once it's there, you can inject the air, and you can see the F mark, which tells us that we have put it the right side up. So this is how the procedure is done. And this is what it looks like on the next day post-op, once the Descemet's membrane is well attached, and the visual recovery is pretty fast. So to summarize, what I would say, if you have a patient of Fuchs dystrophy with cataract, and if there is any corneal edema, be it peripheral or be it central, sometimes they may have some atypical presentations, it may not be central, and if they have any visual symptoms, ask them how do they feel in the morning, if they have any blurriness which clears up as the day goes. And I would say if a pachymetry is more than 570 and above, then I would suggest that we should do a combined procedure and not risk doing a cataract first and then think of doing a transplant, because it's a very high chance that the patient, because the functionality of the endothelium is already compromised. But having said that, there are still patients who do not have any corneal edema and they may have no visual symptoms of morning blurriness and their pachymetry may be low and they have clear compact corneas. So in these cases, one can offer a stage surgery, but I would suggest that it's unpredictable. We still don't know how to define these patients, which ones may decompensate, which ones may not. What if you have some intraoperative complication and damage the endothelium more? So involve the corneal surgeon or whoever is there and send the patient to them so that they can also clinically evaluate and see. To do a specular is maybe it's a medical legally necessary. It's a good thing to do. But important aspect is that the patient understands that he may need a transplant and he may need to go to another surgeon who may need to do it. So even if that happens, there is peace of mind and the patient is also aware. And having said that, I'll confuse you a little more towards the end. This is one patient. If this is the right eye of the lady who had Fuchs and she's undergone cataract surgery by the referring surgeon very well, extremely well. And she's doing very well. But the other eye of this patient had also undergone phaco. And then she decompensated and we had to do a DSEC a few years ago. So there are situations unexplainable. They may be the same patient. In one eye, phaco did well. And the other eye, they decompensated. So it's always good to involve a cornea referral, I would feel, and then make a decision as to what should be done. Thank you very much. I think I'll conclude there.
Yeah, wonderful talk, Ashish. I just had one comment that, you know, in that second group when you said there's no edema and the patient is not symptomatic, I would completely agree with you that to plan only cataract surgery, use a lot of, maybe visco during surgery.
Yeah.
And oftentimes, you know, you'll be surprised, but as you also said that it's important to tell them that you are going to need a transplant in three months.
True.
Just tell them that, so if they don't need it, then they're happy. And, sometimes you'll be surprised for years. Like, I have a patient I'm following up for 5 to 6 years. She's maintained at 6/12, 6/9 vision, and she's happy.
True. I think,
so
I think all of us would have many patients with Fuchs, which have very bad endothelium, but they seem to
happy.
Be compact corneas.
Correct.
And we also see similar situations in grafts. Sometimes when we look at grafts, 5-year-old grafts, they have a 400 cell count.
Exactly.
But they are absolutely compact and clear.
Yeah.
But we don't know. There may be a subgroup of Fuchs who behave like this, but till we know how to identify them.
Yeah,
I
think you're an absolutely skilled DMEC surgeon, I would still think it's in these kind of cases best to just do cataract first. Yeah.
So if suppose somebody does not have access to the keratoplasty, DMEC or something, so he should do a cataract surgery and send it to the corneal surgeon.
Yes.
Any modification in the biometry needs to be done.
Yes.
I mean, do these patients become after surgery? Suppose patient was emetropic and you do DSEC, whether they become plus or minus. So that suppose I'm doing a cataract, I'm not doing cornea. And if I want to refer the patient after doing a cataract surgery, whether I should keep patients slightly on the minus side or the plus side.
True, sir. So I think that's a very important point that you raised. So if in these times, DSEC usually does cause a hyperopic shift. So that from that perspective, you should try and make it counteract for that. But with a DMEC, it seems to be fairly neutral in most surgeons' hands. It doesn't seem to have any refractive impact.
Yes.
Are the corneal surgeons able to get DMEC in the first go, or they need to waste few corneas? I mean, because once in a while we are seeing a live surgery and the surgeon attempted 3 times and wasted 3 cornea before he could get the DMEC graft. So whether most of them are now competent enough to get the DMEC, or it's still
I think a lot of us, I think with the main thing which changed the course of DMEC was the stamping. So now there was no unpredictability which side is up.
Yes. Yes.
And I think as time is going, we are having a lot of workshops and training. I think a lot of us are becoming more and more proficient in DMEC.
Yes,
now.
I agree. And if you're referring
But it has a long learning curve, you're right.
Surgeon who's doing DSEC, then definitely aim for at least one to one and a half diopters of myopia, for
one
sure.
And a half diopter.
Yes, one diopter for sure.
So it is the amount of phaco energy that you have used that it makes the cornea vulnerable for decompensation or?
Is the amount of phaco emulsification,
the phaco energy that you have used?
Yeah, so of course, I mean, as we know, even in a normal situation, if we use a certain phaco energy which can damage the endothelium, some of them will have edema which may persist for a longer time till the endothelium migrates and recovers.
So on these grounds, can you say that flax will do better in such cases?
Flax, I'm unaware. I don't think there has been any proven way to show that it reduces the endothelial cell damage. But yes, there may be certain, if you're doing it regularly, there may be certain hard cataracts, which it may reduce to some components.
Flax has got no role whatsoever in protection of the endothelium.
I'll just share one.
Just
experience.
All these studies have shown, and any time you do any procedure in the eye, endothelial loss is going to take place. And it is how nicely and how well you do your surgery that is more important.
Sir,
how away from the cornea, how much your viscoat is there, these all things, I mean, and the flak itself causes a lot of inflammation. So this flak, and if you just do a little bit of aspiration closer to the cornea is gone in any case, whether it's a flax or non-flax. So it makes no difference.
So
it is the awareness in your mind that I got to be away from the cornea and take